You will find no one. When you are in stress, in difficulties, in illness, loss in the work, crisis, or in financial disturbance, no true friends or relatives stand by you at the moment you need. Am I right? Hold on. There's someone who cares for you, thinks about you, prays for you, and fights for you. Yes, you are right. Your family, the only strength at the very needy moment. We always try to hide our problems with others, but our family can see through it and understands us. Facing medical problems alone can be a nightmare. Family potentially helps solve all these problems and can make sure that food, water, rest, and medical care is provided. Even if they don't condone our actions most of the time, but they love unconditionally. They're always there for us. Hello there, Yasmin here from My Education, My Power, and today we'll learn the value of a family through this lesson. We are not afraid to die if we can all be together, from the book Hornbill, Class 11. Let's talk about the authors. There are two authors of this lesson. Jordan Cook, in a two-time Canadian Olympic sailor, he sails for the Royal Canadian Yacht Club. He is the son of Stephen Cook and Linda Cook. He had a great interest in writing stories. Alan East, he is a co-founder of a multi-academy trust and Central Academies Trust, which has its aim improving standards in secondary education. Let's have a glimpse of the characters. Author, a 37-year-old businessman. Mary, author's wife. Jonathan, 6-year-old son of the author. Suzanne, 7-year-old girl of the author. Larry Vigil, American crewman. Herb Siegler, Swiss crewman. So friends, basically the author and his family had always dreamt of sailing in the British waters. In this chapter, you will study about the adventure and the struggle of this family during the voyage. The never accepting defeat attitude by all the family members is beautiful to learn. Let's get started. In July 1976, the narrator, 37-year-old businessman, along with his wife Mary and two children, Jonathan and Suzanne, set sail from Plymouth, England, as they have dreamt to voyage around the world like the famous Captain James Cook. To become acquainted with sea travelling, they started travelling regularly for the past 16 years, just to get perfect into it. They have got professionally built wooden hull boat named Wave Walker. Before sailing, the boat has been tested for months in all kinds of the roughest weathers. The initial phase of the 3-year long journey of 1,05,000 km proved to be quite pleasant. The narrator took two crewmen before heading towards the east to tackle the roughest sea, the Southern Indian Ocean. Their names were Larry Vigil, an American, and Herb Siegler, a Swiss. On the second day in Cape Town, they witnessed and experienced a strong wind which continued for several weeks. A strong wind was not a problem, but 15 meters high waves, which were the height of the mast, worried the narrator. By December 25, they managed to reach 3,500 kilometers east of Cape Town. Despite the bad weather, the family celebrates Christmas on the boat. However, the weather was getting worse with the passing time. On the early morning of January 2, the family faces strong, huge waves and noisy winds. They attempt to slow down the boat by dropping the storm jib at the speed of 8 knots. They carry out life raft drill and prepare themselves for the worst case scenario by wearing life jackets and oilskins. Around 6 p.m., an unpleasant silence rolled over. It was an indication of a big disaster, which was about to happen. The wind suddenly dropped and the sky was darker with heavy clouds. A huge cloud was coming towards the stern of the ship, but later the narrator realized it was a huge wave. The wave was perfectly vertical and it was twice the height of the previous waves. The thunder increased and the wave moved the ship up. They thought that it would not do any damage, but a huge explosion vibrated the deck. The narrator's head smashed in the wheel of the ship. A very big wave hits the deck of the boat, throwing the narrator off the boat. He accepts his approaching death and begins to lose consciousness. The narrator's head popped out of the water. The ship was about to overturn, but a wave turned her upright. His lifeline jacket was stretched. He grabbed the guardrails and sailed to the ship's main pole. The waves tossed him around the deck. He was injured as his left ribs cracked, his mouth filled with blood, and he had a broken tooth. He found the wheel lying the stern for the next wave and awaited. There was water everywhere. The narrator could feel water below the ship, but he didn't leave the wheel alone. Suddenly, the front door opened and his wife, Mary, came towards him with shouting and said that the decks are smashed. We are full of water. We are going to die. The narrator handed her the wheel and climbed towards the door. The crewmen, Larry and Herb, were pumping the water very fast. Many parts of the boat were broken. The starboard of the ship had sunk. Clothes, crockery, charts, tins and toys were roaming around in the deep water. The narrator swam and crawled to the children's cabin and asked the children whether they are all right. The children replied yes. Suzanne, his daughter, complained about a big bump on her head. But the narrator didn't pay much attention to it, as his major concern was to save them. The narrator found screws, hammer and canvas. He went back to the deck. The broken starboard side was letting so much water into it. If the narrator could not fix the problem on time, they would all sink in the water. The narrator stretched a canvas cloth and secured a waterproof hatch which covered the gaping holes. The hand pump was blocked as rubbish was floating around the cabins and entered it. The electric pump short-circuited. He found another electric pump under the chart room. He connected it to an outpipe and it started working. They all awakened up for an entire night by pumping out the water, steering the wheel and tried to connect the radio. There were no replies to the signals sent over the radio as they were in the remotest part of the world. Suzanne's head was now more swollen with a deep cut in her arm. When upon being asked why she didn't tell him about her injuries earlier, she said that she didn't want to worry him as he was trying to save all of them. The water level was under control by the morning of January 3, so all of them took 2 hours rest. But there still was a leak somewhere below the waterline. Upon checking, the boat rib structure was badly broken down till the base of the ship. The whole section of starboard was held together with a few cupboard partitions. The ship's condition was so bad that it would not reach Australia. The narrator checked the charts and calculated that there were two small islands a few kilometers to the east. One of them was Lee Amsterdam, which was a French scientific base. Their only hope was to search and reach that island, but only if the wind and the sea do not cause further damage, else their chances were slim. The wave had destroyed the ship's secondary engine very badly. After 36 hours of continuous pumping on January 4, the water was only a few centimeters left to be pumped out, but they still had to pump out the water which was coming in. They could not set sail on the main mast. They hoisted a storm jib and sailed towards the two small islands. They had their first meal in 2 days, some corned beef and cracker biscuits found by Mary. Again, another worst happening was about to knock. The black clouds again built up around 4 p.m. The wind was now 40 knots and the sea was getting higher. The weather got worse. And by the early morning of January 5, the situation was bad. When the narrator went to comfort his children, his son asked him whether they are going to die. He tried to assure him that they would make it. His son replied that they were not afraid to die till they all were together. This filled the narrator with a determination to fight back. He made all the efforts to protect the weakened starboard side. He used an improvised sea anchor made of heavy nylon rope and 2 22-liter plastic barrels of kerosene. That same evening, the narrator and his wife sat holding hands and they believed that their end was near. The ship made it through the storm and by the morning of January 6, the narrator tried to get reading on the sextant. He worked with wind speeds, drift and current and calculated their position. They were in 150,000 kilometers area of ocean, looking for a 65 kilometer wide island, which was quite impossible. While the narrator was still thinking, his daughter Suzanne joined him, and she was in pain. The left side of her head was swollen. She gave him a card which she had made herself. She made him laugh by showing funny words written on it with funny pictures. Inside of the card, she wrote how much she loved them and she thanked them. This made the narrator realize that they had to make it to the island. The narrator rechecked his calculations. He estimated the influence of the westerly currents which flow through the Indian Ocean. Around 2 p.m., he went on deck and asked Larry to steer the wheel to 185 degrees. He felt if they were lucky, they would see the island by 5 p.m. Then he went below and slept. He woke up around 6 p.m. and it was dark outside. He thought that they might have missed the island. He started worrying about how they would tackle the westerly wind as the ship wasn't capable to sail more. His son came and asked him for a hug. His daughter followed. Then the narrator asked his children that why was he getting a hug? His son replied that he was the best daddy in the world and also called him the best captain. The narrator replied that he was afraid. Suzanne told him then that they had found the island which was as big as the battleship. The narrator rushed to the deck and gave a sigh of relief. They could see the complete outline of Lee Amsterdam. There was a bleak piece of volcanic rock in front of them. It had a little vegetation. It was the most beautiful island in the world. They tied the ship at some distance from the shore, and the next morning, 28 inhabitants of the Amsterdam island helped them to move on the shore of the land. As he felt the land again on his feet, he thought of his crewmen and his wife. He also thought of his 7-year-old daughter who was injured very badly. She had to go through 6 minor operations to remove the blood clot in her head. His son who never gave up and was not afraid to die. So friends, the title of the story, We Are Not Afraid to Die If We Can All Be Together, is perfectly justified. The story is about a positive attitude and endurance shown by the courageous family of the author in the face of the storm that had endangered their survival. Not only the elder members of the family, the 6-year-old son and the 7-year-old daughter stood by his father and motivated him throughout the journey. The 6-year-old son Jonathan reassured his dad that he was not afraid to die if he could be all together with his family. So these fearless words encouraged the author to do his best to save the damaged boat. His son's fearless words later on become the title of the story. So this is all for today. Hope you liked the lesson. See you again with another topic. Till then, take care. Bye for now.